Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to this webinar. Today we're going to be talking about the ABR, or the auditory brainstem response. Now there's many applications for the ABR, but today I want to talk about the threshold ABR. And I want to keep this webinar at an introductory level, but hopefully those of you who are still doing ABR can still pick up a few techniques or a few tips and tricks to help improve your daily practice. Before we begin, I would just like to give you a little bit of information about me. My name's Lee Martin and I'm an audiologist from the UK and I now manage the Intro-Acoustics Academy. I hope you're all familiar with the Academy and the work that we do. If not, we are the branch of Intro-Acoustics which deals with training and education in diagnostic technologies and their applications. If you haven't done so already, I really encourage you to visit our website where we have a host of materials and many related materials to this webinar, which you can use to build your knowledge in ABR, such as masking the ABR, the FMP and residual noise graphs, and I'll give you links to these at the end of our time together. Firstly, I'd like to just recap on the learning outcomes so that we're all on the same page. We're going to start the session by looking at the principles and the origins of the ABR. This is really core in understanding this technique and this measurement. So we'll spend a bit of time here. Once we've got that polished and understood, we'll then progress and get into the nuts and bolts of the measurement, how to prepare the patient, and how to actually perform the measurement. Lastly, we'll have a look at what we do once you've got the measurement and how we actually interpret the waveforms that we have on screen. If you have any questions along the way, please type them in the instant messaging box and we'll answer those at the end of the session. One thing I just wanted to stress at this point is that this webinar is going to focus on air conduction only. I understand that bone conduction forms a large portion of threshold ABR, but in order to get through all the content, we're just going to focus on air conduction for today. Now, when we're talking about ABR, we have to think of it in the bigger context. ABR is actually a small member of a much larger family of measurements which we can use to measure brain activity. We've been measuring brain activity for quite a few years. Berger was the first to do so, or document it, in 1929, where he was able to record EEG from the intact scalp of humans. What you can see on this image of the head is that I've placed a series of electrodes just as Berger did in his experiments, and what he was able to do was to pick up the spontaneous activity which was happening in the brain. Now, measuring this spontaneous activity has many clinical applications, particularly in epilepsy and sleep disorders, as well as anesthesia and coma patients. Measuring spontaneous activity is fantastic, but what we're really interested in is not just measuring spontaneous activity, but in fact how the brain responds to a stimulus. And this is called evoked potentials or event-related potentials. And we can define an evoked potential as a brain response that is a direct result of a specific sensory, cognitive, or motor event. In the world of audiology, we are most focused on sound. So what we can do is we can present a sound, and what we would hope for is to see some form of change in the brain once that sound has been presented to the ear. However, the problem that the scientists found in the 1900s was that they weren't able to pick up these responses to stimuli in the brain. And the reason why is that the spontaneous activity in the brain was just so dominant, and the response to the sound was very, very small. It took another 30 years in order to actually get the technology to a level where we were actually able to effectively record auditory evoked potentials. And the techniques that allowed us to do it was firstly signal averaging, which was described by Dawson in 1951, and secondly the development of the averaging computer in the late 50s. The way in which signal averaging works is that rather than just presenting one sound to the ear and subsequently to the brain, we present multiple sounds. If we present multiple sounds, the signal will be constant, but the noise or the spontaneous activity in the brain will be random. Therefore, if you present enough of these stimuli, the random noise will eventually cancel out and you'll be left with activity. And we can see that by this circle here. Now, the ABR actually wasn't the first response to be recorded successfully. The first response was the cortical response, and that was because this is a much larger response than the ABR. In 1971, Jewett and Willistone were the first to publish a paper describing the auditory brainstem response. What they described was a series of 7 waves, with wave 5 being the largest wave. Clinically, what we see today is we don't really talk about wave 6 and 7 because they're variable and of little clinical significance. However, waves 1 to 5 are very much still in use today. And when we're talking about threshold ABR, as we are in this presentation, wave 5 is the most important wave for us to focus on. And much of our remaining time will be focusing on this wave. Before I do so, what I'd like to do is just talk a little bit about the waveform generation and where these different waves come from. Now, I don't want to get too bogged down in the anatomy and physiology behind the generators of the auditory brainstem response, but there are just a couple of points that I'd like to make. Firstly, we know that the early waves come from the compound action potential and the auditory nerve. However, once we get past those early waves, the anatomy and physiology of the response becomes much more complex, and it's difficult to pinpoint a generator. A lovely study was done by Moucher and colleagues in 1996, which showed the complexity of this response. Rather than focusing on the difficult part, what I want to do is just to give you the message that really what we know about this response from all these studies is that it does originate from the brainstem, and the most important thing about the brainstem is that it's not affected by sleep. If we go back to the earlier responses which were recorded, like the corticals, these responses are not mature at birth and they diminish during sleep. That makes them not very effective for testing babies. Now, we have a test to measure hearing threshold in adults. We have the pure tone audiogram, but we didn't have a test to measure hearing threshold effectively in babies. And ABR has given us this test because, being from the brainstem, it can be performed with child sleeping. And that leads us to the application of the ABR. And as we know, and why we're doing this whole webinar today, is that threshold ABR is the biggest use for this technology. However, what we can see is this waveform covers a stretch of the brainstem, and therefore you can measure the neurological function of the brainstem using the ABR also. This was very popular in the 1980s and warrants a whole webinar in itself. So what we'll do now is really just narrow our focus and select the threshold ABR as our application for today. So what do you need to be able to perform a threshold ABR? Well, there's a few things. The first, we need a patient. And second of all, we need a stimulus. And you can see on this image that we have a choice of 3 different stimuli. We have insert headphones, we have supraoral headphones, and we have a bone vibrator. We'll talk about each of those in a little bit more detail later. Once we've got a stimulus and we're going to deliver it to the child, we need to pick up that brain activity. And therefore, we need some electrodes to stick onto our baby. But before we do that, we need to actually prepare the skin so that they're going to have the best contact for those electrodes. Once those electrodes are on, we then need to connect that to a preamplifier, which is going to amplify the signal, reduce the noise, and then pass that through into the Eclipse, which is going to do the signal averaging and to be able to show us the ABR waveform, which we'd see on screen. Let's break down each of those components in a little bit more detail, starting off with the patient. If you're going to be doing a threshold ABR on a patient, then it's really important to do a couple of steps before the appointment begins. And the biggest one is to actually send out a pre-appointment letter detailing what's going to happen. Imagine you're a parent and you're having to bring your child in to have their hearing assessed to see if they have a hearing loss. That can be quite worrying for the parent. Also, when you start to stick the electrodes onto the child, that can be a worrying or scary time for the parents. So the more information you can give them at the beginning of the appointment, the better and more successful the appointment will be. Secondly, what you want to do is look at the notes of the patient before they arrive. This can give you some useful information, particularly if they've had a newborn hearing screen prior. It will help you know which ear to test. It'll also let you know if there's any other things which you need to be considering during the appointment. If it is a baby which we're going to be testing, then it's really important that the child is recently fed. Remember, we want the child to be sleeping and we don't want them to be waking up because they're hungry. And also, babies tend to normally have a little nap after they've been fed, so the two work hand in hand. If we're going to expect the patient to sleep during the measurement, then we also need them to be clothed appropriately for the appointment. So you don't want them coming in their best clothes, but instead something light, something comfortable, so that they can sleep. Lastly, you want to make sure that the patient doesn't have any oils on their skin or makeup if it's an adult. Anything which is going to cause a barrier between the skin and the electrode is going to cause poor impedances and affect the quality of the results. So if you can advise the patient beforehand in the pre-appointment letter, then you'll spend less time in your appointment having to clean that skin up in order to get the best contact for your electrodes. In ABR measurements, we also need to be very aware of the environment that we're testing in. And there's several different noise sources which can affect ABR measurements, and we can break those down into three types of noise. The first is patient noise, and this is muscle activity predominantly. And that's why we want the patient to be asleep or relaxed as possible, because muscle activity will contaminate the results as too much noise will come into the recording. So we have to create an environment which is friendly for sleep. So we need to have a bed, we need to have a blanket, we need to have a pillow so the patient is comfortable. The room should be decorated in a friendly way so that it doesn't look too daunting, so it's not scary, so the patient can relax and feel comfortable. Secondly, we have ambient noise. Ambient noise is just sounds in the environment. And when we're doing ABR, we want to measure the quietest sounds a person can hear. So it's really important that we ensure that the environment meets a certain standard. We don't do pure tone audiometry in a noisy clinic room, so we shouldn't do ABRs in a noisy clinic room, as this will just contaminate the results. Ideally, we should be using the same environment as we do a pure tone audiogram in, i.e. a sound booth. If you cannot have access to a soundproof booth, then really try and find the quietest area in your clinic or in the patient's home, wherever you're doing the measurement, in order to get the best possible recordings. The last type of noise which can contaminate the recording is electrical noise. And this comes from many different sources. It can come from the lights in the room, it can come from mobile phones, but the biggest one comes from the actual grounding of the plugs, which you plug the ABR machine to into the wall. It's important that you have a proper ground inside the wall, which will eliminate a lot of the electrical noise. If the room isn't grounded, then there's going to be a lot of electrical noise, and then you're going to have to average for much longer, which is going to prolong your test time. Another form of electrical noise is if you're testing the patient on a metal bed. Sometimes they can act as a capacitor. So to eliminate that, what you have to do is have a secondary ground which grounds the bed to the Evoke Potentials device. And this will provide you with much better recordings. There's lots of stimuli used in ABR, but the most common stimulus that we usually use is not available, the pure tone. And that's because the ABR is a transient response and you wouldn't be able to record an ABR with this stimulus. Therefore, we need to look to different stimuli. The most common stimulus which has been used in the past is the click. But if we compare the click to the pure tone, we can see on this graph we have a 1000 Hz pure tone. We can see that the click stimulates a range of different frequencies from 250 Hz all the way up with its peak around 2 to 4 kHz. So what we have is that we have the click It can produce very robust ABRs, but it's not frequency specific. An improvement on the click is the CE chirp. We can see on the graph that it has the same frequency specificity as the click, but what this stimulus does is it reorganizes the frequencies in the stimulus so that they match the traveling delay of the cochlea. And by doing this, you can get a response which is up to 2 times greater than the click response. So again, although it's not frequency specific, you get a very nice large ABR. Inga Firm, who's been a pioneer in studying them, has done a webinar on behalf of the Academy, and this is available on the Academy website. Rather than looking at broadband stimuli, what we want to do really in threshold ABR is to measure frequency-specific hearing. Now, the way that we do that, if we can't do a pure tone, is to use a tone burst. And what you can see is the frequency specificity of a tone burst here. We can see that the center frequency is at 1000 Hertz, but we can see that there's spectral splatter in the low and the high frequencies, and it's around about an octave wide in its actual stimulus area. Now, this is fine for ABR recordings, but we have to be aware that it isn't a pure tone. The consequence of using a tone burst in a comparison to a click or a CE chirp is that you're going to get a poorer waveform morphology. This is something which we have to accept in order to get a more frequency-specific hearing threshold. To help us improve that waveform morphology, Interacoustics have developed the narrowband CE chirps. Just like the CE chirp, these narrowband CE chirp actually give us a much larger response amplitude than the tone burst. What we can see on the graph is the frequency specificity of the tone burst. We can see that it has a very slightly broader center frequency, but no spectral splatter, which makes it pretty equivalent to the tone burst. But of course, this stimulus being 1.5 to 2 times larger ABR responses. Therefore, we can see that there's been a huge international shift between using clicks and tone bursts to CE chirps and narrowband CE chirps. And the studies which have been performed to show this, I've presented at the bottom, and you can see that Inga Firm is the author of two of the most famous of these studies. In addition to choosing the type of stimulus, there's a few other things that we need to do. We need to choose the ear which we're going to start testing, and what we recommend is that you choose the better hearing ear. It's much better to confirm that one ear is normal, particularly in a newborn baby. This is the information that the parents want to know. So if you have an ear which is past the screen, it's still best to ensure that it's past the ABR and you know that they're going to be developing good speech and language skills. You can then investigate the second ear and then identify if there's a hearing loss and if that needs to be aided. In terms of intensity, this is driven by what you know already. Typically, most babies which will be referred from a newborn hearing screening will still probably have a normal ABR. So you don't want to start too loud. So instead, you want to start around about 40 dB above the suspected threshold and then measure down. The UK recommend that you should get a clear ABR at threshold, at a response above threshold, and a response just below threshold. And really, if we can do those three in as small a steps as possible, then that's what you want to try and achieve. Once we've chosen the intensity, we should choose the frequency. We now know that we want to be doing frequency specific testing. The aim of the game here is to choose a high frequency and a low frequency so that you can cover the broad range of the audiogram. And commonly, the following frequencies are paired together: 4000 and 1000 Hertz, and 500 Hertz and 2000 Hertz. Once we have the frequency, we need to choose the rate at which we're going to stimulate the ear at. The rate is very important because if the rate is too slow, then the test will be too long. And if the rate is too fast, then you're going to get a poor waveform morphology. The thing to remember about the rate is that our main focus in threshold ABR is recording wave 5. Therefore, we don't need to worry about the other waves, and that allows us to actually use very fast rates. So the newborn hearing screening program in the UK recommends a rate of 45.1 in neonates at 2000 and 4000 Hz. So what this means is that you can very quickly perform a test and get good quality recordings so that you can test as many different frequencies as possible. Lastly, you need to choose a polarity. So stimulus polarity can come in many different forms: condensation, rarefaction, or alternating. The thing to remember is that if we're using a high rate, then the polarity doesn't really have too much of an effect on the waveform. Therefore, an alternating stimulus is the recommended polarity of choice in threshold ABR, and the main reason for that is because it can eliminate stimulus artifact. We also have a choice between transducer. We can use an insert phone or a supraoral headphone. What we're finding worldwide is that there's a huge push for people using insert headphones, and that's for three core reasons. Firstly, less masking is required because there's an increased interaural attenuation. Secondly, there's a reduced stimulus artifact. Lastly, they're much easier to place. When placing a supraoral headphone, sometimes you don't know if you have the headphone so that the sound is being delivered directly to the ear canal. Whereas with the insert headphone, you can choose an appropriate size tip and perfectly place that into the ear and very comfortably know that you're providing the correct sound simulation. If we're doing bone conduction, there's a choice of two bone vibrators, the B81 and the B71. The B81 is the new version of the B71, and it provides less distortion, it can stimulate at higher intensities, and its separate casing makes it more robust. So again, with bone conduction, the obvious choice is the B81. Now that we've sorted out the stimulus and the transducers, we need to think about the electrodes and how we're going to place them on the head. Just to give you a bit of background about electrode montages, the way that evoked potentials work is that they measure the difference in signal recorded from a pair of electrodes. And typically what you do is you place one electrode over an area of high activity and a second electrode over an area of low activity. And what you'll do is, as I say, you'll measure the difference in signal from these two electrodes. So this video demonstrates this. As the sound goes into the ear, what you'll do is you're going to be picking up a difference between electrode 1 and electrode 2, and that's demonstrated by the voltmeter at the top and the graph being generated at the bottom. This is what we'll see in the Eclipse software when we start to do some ABR recordings. When we do ABR, rather than just doing two electrodes, we actually usually perform it with four electrodes. We have one active electrode, which is positioned on the vertex or the high forehead. We have two reference electrodes, which sit on the right and left mastoids. So these are the areas of low activity. The reason why we have two reference electrodes is that we can set the patient up once and then perform testing on both ears without having to move electrodes or disturb the patient during testing. Lastly, we have a ground electrode, which is going to be positioned on the low forehead or cheek to reduce noise. As I mentioned before, you can't just pit the electrodes onto the skin without doing some preparation first. What you need to do is to make sure that the skin has the best possible contact to the electrode. This involves using some skin preparation gel, such as NuPrep, and either some gauze or a cotton pad to clean the electrode site. When cleaning the electrode site, you want to make sure that you don't clean the whole head, just the size of the electrode and where it's going to be positioned. It just needs a small amount so that you can make an effective clean site. It's important to wipe off the preparation gel afterwards. Once that's done, you can place the electrodes. So the black going on the low forehead. If the forehead of the baby is small, you can actually move this to the cheek, which is often used in many clinics. You have the left electrode, which is going to go on the earlobe or the left mastoid, depending on which area you've cleaned. The same on the right, and the active on the high forehead. The baby's now set up for the measurement. The last thing you need to do is just to make sure that you have the electrode cables braided, because that will reduce noise common between the different electrode sites. And lastly, check the impedance on the preamplifier. With impedance, what we expect to see is that if we have a good contact with the skin, we'd want to see the impedances below 5 kilo-ohms. However, it's most important that the impedances between all four electrode sites are balanced. So that means it's better to have four impedances at 5 kilo-ohms rather than one at 0.5, one at 2, one at 3, and one at 5 kilo-ohms. If you have unbalanced impedances, then it's best to take off the electrode, prepare the skin again, and see if you can balance up those levels. Before you start testing, it's important that you separate the transducer and the electrodes. So typically what we do is we place the transducer above the patient's head, and so that the insert earphone comes from behind the patient. We then rest the preamplifier in front of the patient or near their chest with the electrodes coming up. By doing this, what we can do is eliminate stimulus artifact. If the two cross, then you will get stimulus artifact in your recordings. Now we're ready to perform a measurement. So what we're going to do is we're going to choose a stimulus in the left ear of 40 dB and we're going to see what comes through. So very quickly we can see in the green area, which shows us where we expect to see wave 5, a response that looks quite similar to what we'd expect. But what I want to do is stop the measurement here, because there's a few things which are happening behind the scenes that we haven't talked about and are important for ABR measurements. The first technology I want to explain is artifact rejection. Artifact rejection is a technique to eliminate high levels of EEG signal. High levels of EEG signal can actually contaminate the recording, so we don't want those to be coming through. Now, the UK NHSP guidance actually has several different recommendations. We also provide some recommendations for adults in our protocols. So what I want you to do is focus on the graph on the left. Each time we send a sound into the ear, we're going to record a response from the brain, and that response is going to have a signal component and a noise component. What we want to do is to make sure that the noise component isn't too big, because that will contaminate our recordings. We do that by setting a rejection level. If the response we record exceeds the rejection level, then we reject it and don't include it. If it's below, then we allow it to go in for analysis. When choosing the level of rejection, there's a couple of things which you need to do. So at the minute, we have a level of 10 microvolts set as the rejection, so this signal would be accepted. However, if we reduce the level to 3 microvolts, this is a more strict rejection level, and this signal would be rejected. The benefit of setting a more strict artifact rejection level is that you're going to get cleaner recordings. The consequence is that it's going to take a long time to do the test. Whereas if we increase the rejection level, we're going to allow more noise into the recordings, but it's going to make test time faster. A technology which is related to artifact rejection is something called Bayesian weighting. Now, in order to understand Bayesian weighting, you have to understand how traditional averaging works. So we know that signal averaging involves multiple sounds being presented to the ear, and we can see these sounds in this graph here. We know that if the sound is above the rejection level, then it's rejected and not counted, and if it's below the rejection level, then we include it in the analysis. If we look at this section here, we can see that there is a large amount of noise in this sweep, as it's close to the rejection level. Whereas in this one, it's a very small amount of noise. but you can see that they both have the same weighting. You can see it again here. This sweep has a small amount of noise, and this sweep has a large amount of noise. But from what I described in the last slide, this sweep is more valuable to us because it contains less noise. So they shouldn't have the same weighting. And that's what Bayesian weighting does. Instead of actually giving each sound the same weighting, what it will do is it will identify the sounds with a low noise content and weight them higher than sounds which have a high noise content. The effect of this clinically is that if the patient has transient bursts of activity or moves, then this isn't going to cause an influx of noise into the recording and contaminate the result. Lightfoot and Stevens in 2014 actually did a study looking at this, and their conclusion was that if you have Bayesian weighting, then it should be switched on. The last thing I want to talk about, which is happening behind the scenes on the AVR, is signal filtering. Now, the thing to remember with signal filtering is that when you have electrodes connected to a patient, then they can actually pick up a wide range of activity. But the ABR doesn't cover that entire range of activity. So if we imagine this graph is showing all the different types of activity that we can pick up, then the ABR is only going to be focused around certain activity areas. So to be more effective and to eliminate noise or unwanted activity coming from either side of the signal which we are trying to measure, we can place some filters into the system to improve that. So the first type of filter we can place is a high pass filter. What this means is it allows high frequencies to pass and filters out the low frequencies. All this low activity will be cancelled out, and we'll be able to measure all the activity going up into the higher frequencies. However, we don't want all the high frequency activity to be measured, so we then enforce a low pass filter. This allows the low frequencies to pass. So that's going to block out the high frequencies. And now what we've done is we've cornered off the ABR signal so that we can just focus on measuring this. We call this the window of acceptance. Now, you can make these filters stronger or more aggressive. But as you can see, if we do that, then what's going to happen is that we're going to start to eliminate part of the ABR signal from our recordings. And that's not something that we want to do. Therefore, the NHSP recommendations in the UK recommend a high pass filter of 30 Hz and a low pass filter of 1,500 Hz. And I really recommend that you stick to these filter settings. This section of the Threshold ABR webinar is going to talk about when to stop recording and how to make interpretations of your ABR waveforms. Remember that the ABR recorded using a Threshold ABR technique is not going to have the same morphology as those which you see in the textbooks. That's because we're using a very high rate and we're using different filter settings, because we're only interested in seeing wave 5. What I'm going to do is I'm going to start an ABR measurement. And the question which I want you to think about is, when should you stop recording this measurement? What you can see on screen, again, where the green shaded region is here, is where we'd expect to see wave 5. And we can see a nice waveform deflection. So therefore, can we stop testing? Or do we need to continue testing until a certain criteria is met? Our friends in the NHSP UK guidance document recommend that the number of sweeps per waveform accepted should be varied depending on both the size of the response and the level of background activity. What that really translates to is that they're looking for a signal-to-noise ratio, and they state in their documents that they expect the signal to be 3 times larger than the noise before you can stop testing. However, just by looking at this waveform on the screen, you cannot tell how much noise is present in the signal. And therefore, we have several different approaches in order to make estimations of noise in the ABR trace. The first of those, and the most additional of those, is to actually run a set number of sweeps. The idea here is that if you run 2,000 sweeps, then in theory the noise should be sufficiently low and therefore that ABR should be present on the screen. However, we found that this isn't really very effective because 2,000 sweeps in a patient which is moving will produce a very different ABR than 2,000 sweeps in a patient which is sound asleep. This is where the Intraacoustics Eclipse has some really nice technologies to help us out. Those are residual noise and FMP. So the message here is that we shouldn't be using traditional methods such as running 2,000 sweeps, but rather rely on more accurate estimations of residual noise, such as the residual noise algorithm, FMP, or looking at signal to noise using the UK NHSP technique. So let's break down how the residual noise calculator works in the Eclipse. Is that we actually measure the variance across 5 points on the waveform. So if you imagine, as we input sounds, the variance on the waveform is going to be very high at the beginning because there's a high level of residual noise. However, as we continue testing and that noise becomes reduced, that variance is going to reduce. It's when that variance is at a low level, then we can actually estimate that there's a small amount of noise in the recording and we can stop testing. In infants, we use a value of 25 nanovolts. In the next few slides, I'll show you how this looks like in the ABR software. Before I do that, I just want to explain briefly the FMP calculation. FMP is a measure of signal to noise. So in order to measure the signal, what we can do is we can set a baseline and then we can measure the degree of signal over a pre-calculated range. The noise is easy to measure because we've already done that with the residual noise calculator. So we can just choose the variance and then compare the signal to the noise, which will give us an FMP or statistical calculation of how likely it is that the ABR is a true response, a signal to noise estimation. So if we have an FMP of greater than 7 in infants or 3.1 in adults, then we can have 99% certainty that what we're seeing on the screen is a true ABR response. This makes residual noise and FMP a really formidable tool in helping clinicians know when to stop and ensuring that they have really high quality ABR recordings. So what does it look like in the ABR software? If you're not used to seeing residual noise and FMP, then in the Eclipse, where they live is above the waveform recordings and you can see them up here. Let me blow that graph up a little bit for you to break down a little bit more. What we can see is along the bottom here, we have number of sweeps. And what we have on the left-hand side is FMP, and on the right-hand side, residual noise. Let's start with residual noise. What we can see on this scale is a nanovolt scale. So 200 nanovolts is going to be a high level of residual noise, whereas 40 nanovolts or 25 nanovolts in children is going to be an acceptable level of residual noise. So what happens? Well, as we know, at the beginning of the test, the residual noise is high. But as we continue averaging or increase the number of sweeps, the residual noise is going to reduce. And then we know when to stop testing because I've already given you the values on the previous slide. FMP, on the other hand, is a signal to noise calculation. So if the noise is high, then we'd expect the FMP to start low. And as the noise reduces, we'd expect the FMP to increase if an ABR is present. So what you can actually do is look at the residual noise and FMP graph, and this will tell you when you can stop recording. So in this situation, what we have is a high FMP, a low residual noise, and what we'd expect to see in this situation on screen is a very clear ABR response. In this situation, we know that it's present, it's of good quality, and we can stop testing. Let's look at another scenario that could happen in the clinic. In this situation, what we can see is that we have a low FMP and a low residual noise. What we can tell in this situation is that despite the noise being low, therefore the quality being very good, there is not an ABR present. And what we'd expect to see on the screen is something flat like this. So this tells us no ABR present, quality is high, so we can stop testing. This situation is different. What we can see is that we have a low FMP, but we also have a very high residual noise. And what we'd expect to see on the screen is something quite noisy, something quite messy that doesn't look like an ABR. In this situation, we don't know if the ABR is present or absent, and therefore we need to continue testing. We know that we need to continue testing because the residual noise is too high, therefore the quality is bad. There's one of two outcomes with this. You can reduce the residual noise and then the FMP will increase and we'll see a response, or you can reduce the residual noise and the FMP will still stay low, and this will tell us that a response is absent. But regardless, if you see this situation, you need to continue testing. Lastly, we have this scenario. Here we can see a high FMP, but we can also see a high residual noise. So this means we have a 99% confidence that a true ABR is present on the screen, but the quality of the recording isn't very good because the residual noise is very high. This is where the audiologist needs to step in, and they need to use their interpretation skills to decide on the next suitable step. So let's move on and look at what questions you need to ask before making a interpretation. So what we can see on this screen is an ABR which has been recorded at 40 dB NHL on the right ear. And we need to make a decision on whether or not it's normal or abnormal. So there's three questions which we need to ask. Firstly, does it look like an ABR? Secondly, is it repeatable? And thirdly, what is the relationship between the signal and the noise? Let's start off with the first of those questions. If we talk about the look and feel, then there's three things that you really need to look at. Firstly, the morphology. Does it even have a wave 5? Are there any abnormal or strange looking waves included in the recording? Or does it look how you would expect? Secondly, what is the latency of the wave 5? Is it correct for the age of the patient? And the nice thing about the Eclipse is that we have normative data, or can input normative data for all age ranges. Lastly, you can look at the amplitude. ABRs are typically 0.1 to 1 microvolts in size. So if you have an ABR which is 2 microvolts, then you may think, actually, something's going on here. But when we look at this waveform on screen, we can see that the morphology looks good, the latency's within the normal limits, and the amplitude, again, is in the range of ABR sizes that we would expect. So from a look and feel perspective, this looks pretty certain that it's an ABR. Secondly, we can look at the repeatability. There's two ways you can look at repeatability. The traditional way would be to run a number of sweeps and then to repeat that for a second time. An alternative way is to use the A and B curves. The A and B curves actually separate half the sweeps into separate bins, and you can compare those to the grand average waveform. So in this situation, we've used an alternating click. So we have rarefaction waves and condensation waves, and those are shown by the A curve showing rarefaction and the B curve showing condensation waves. What we can see in this situation is that the overlap between the condensation and the rarefaction waveforms are actually very similar. The residual noise is low, measured at 40 nanovolts, So actually, there isn't any need to actually do any more repetitions of the curve because we can use the A and B curves and the residual noise. And this is our proof of repeatability. Lastly, we need to look at the signal-to-noise relationship. Again, you could go back and look at the difference between the A and B curves and make an estimation of how much noise is present. Alternatively, you could mark the wave 5 marker and you could mark the trough of the wave 5, and the eclipse would actually make an estimation for you. But of course, what we have in a much easier way is just to use the FMP. And we know that this is from an adult ear, so the FMP is greater than 3.1, the residual noise is lower than 40 nanovolts, so again, we have the criteria met. So from those three questions, we can see that this is a true ABR response. If we go back to the newborn hearing screening program guidance on ABR from the UK, then what they say is that you should be able to classify any ABR waveform into one of three categories: CR, which stands for clear response, RA, which stands for response absent, and INC, which stands for inconclusive. So let's have a look at the definitions of these waveform classifications. So it says for a clear response, there must be a high correlation between the replications of the waveforms. So that goes back to my question about repeatability. It should show the expected characteristics in terms of amplitude, latency, and morphology. That goes back to my question about the look and feel. The next part of the paragraph says that the size and amplitude of the response should be a minimum of 40 nanovolts and at least 3 times bigger than that of background noise. And this one goes back to my estimations measured through FMP, which gives us the 3 times bigger than background noise criteria, and the residual noise, which tells us that the background noise is low. So actually, by asking these three questions, we can actually make and classify our waveforms as per the newborn hearing screening guidance protocol. So what happens if we don't have a clear response? Well, if the quality is good, i.e., that the residual noise is low and there is no form of ABR, meaning that we're pretty much seeing a flat line on screen, then we can call the wave a response absent. And you can see they use the value of 25 nanovolts in their description. Lastly, if the waveform isn't a clear response or a response absent, then it should just be marked as inconclusive. And a way to turn an inconclusive waveform into a clear response waveform is very simple. You just continue averaging, or you run another trace and you merge the curves in order to improve that residual noise calculation. So we've now measured an ABR, but the objective of today's session is actually to find threshold. But hopefully, through this process, I've given you all the skills you need in order to know what to do next. So let's talk about the protocol which you'll use in order to find the patient's hearing threshold. Again, with everything in ABR, it's all about speed versus accuracy. So what we want to do is we don't want to waste time on providing loud intensity stimulus if we suspect a patient to have normal hearing. So normally we want to do is set the stimulus to be 40 dB above the suspected threshold. We know, according to the UK criteria, that the gold standard is to obtain a clear response at threshold, a clear response at super threshold, and a response absent below threshold to demonstrate that this is the true hearing threshold of that patient. So hopefully, what we'd find in a normal hearing patient is that if we started at 40, we then get a clear response, we go down to 20, we get a clear response, and then we go down to 0 and get a response absent. This shows us that we have a clear response above threshold, a clear response at normal hearing, and a response absent below threshold. You could argue that I've used a 20 dB step size here, and that is not going to give me a very accurate estimation of threshold, and I would agree with you. And I would only use that technique in measuring something in a patient with normal hearing. If you have suspected hearing loss, then you really want to be doing 5 dB steps around threshold to find the below threshold and the super threshold measurement. But if the patient is normal and we've measured down to 20 dB, we've demonstrated that they're normal, then the question could be, why do you need to waste time finding the quieter levels if you've already demonstrated that they have sufficient hearing to develop good speech and language skills? So let's have a look at this situation. We can see on the right side that the audiologist started at 40 dB. They managed to get away 5 and a clear response. They've reduced the intensity down to 20 dB. Again, a lovely clear response and wave 5 present. Lastly, they've gone to 0 dB. We can see that there's no response present and we can label that a response absent. On the left-hand side, again, they started at 40 dB, suspecting the patient had normal hearing on this side. They've gone down to 20 dB and again have demonstrated normal hearing. And they have now gone down to 0 dB and have demonstrated a response absent. What they've done in this situation is that they've measured 10 dB. And that goes back to my point on the previous slide. Is this actually necessary in a test which you're just trying to confirm that the patient is going to develop good speech and language skills? And in my opinion, it's not. So as we know, the ABR forms part of the patient journey, and in particular, it forms the backbone of the assessment. But that information which we obtain from the ABR is also going to be used in the amplification stage. And amplification, of course, can come in many forms, but the majority of patients diagnosed with hearing loss are going to have hearing aids. And before I leave you today, I just want to make one point about hearing aids and the ABR results. Because what you need to do is actually convert your measurement which you've measured using the ABR into something which the hearing aid can actually make sense of. As we know, the ABR is measured in dB/NHL, but hearing aids work in dB/SPL, and they work by converting the audiogram, which is measured in dB/HL, to a dB/SPL prescription. But in the ABR, we're measuring using NHL, and in infants, dB/NHL is not equivalent to dB/HL, and a correction needs to be made. So it's really important that once you've measured your ABR responses, that you then apply a correction to turn the thresholds into dB/EHL so that they can then be programmed into the hearing aid. In the past, this was a long-winded process because you had to look at the stimulus correction, you had to look at the age correction, and then add these together and apply it to make an estimation of dB/EHL. Today, the conversion is much easier, and this is because an audiologist in the UK, Adam Chell, has developed this dB/NHL to dB/EHL calculator in Excel, and this is freely accessible on the internet for you to download. So all you need to do is go to the website below at the bottom, download this dB/NHL to EHL calculator, input the values from your clear responses at threshold, and what will be generated is the dB/EHL values in the bottom table. This is a really nice tool, and if you haven't seen it already, I really encourage you to download it as it will make your lives much easier. So just as we're breaking into some more advanced topics in ABR, we find ourselves coming to the end of our presentation. But that's okay, because we have a series of webinars on the Intro-Acoustics Academy website, which cover multiple aspects of threshold ABR. I'm going to highlight 5 of these. The first is that Michael Maslin has done a wonderful webinar on masking the ABR and really breaks down the theory behind it. So if you are going on to do more complex ABRs and doing masking, then I really encourage you to watch that because we've not covered that section today. If you want to know more about how to use the residual noise and FMP graphs, then Jos Huenen has done an equally fantastic job on his webinar, which describes how to use these features. And lastly, the webinar which I mentioned in the presentation performed by Inga Firm, that's also available, which looks at CE chirps and the evidence behind their use in clinical practice. So this brings us to the end of our presentation, and I'd like to use this opportunity now to open the floor to any questions. Whilst we wait for any questions, I'd just like to let you know that this webinar will be available online over the next few days. If you wish to send me any questions personally, then please send them to academy@interacoustics.com, the email address displayed on the screen here, and I'll get them sent back to you ASAP. Well, it doesn't look like we have any questions today, so I'd just like to say thank you very much for listening, and goodbye.